I'm an old man now, I can't do nothing. Young folks don't pay me no mind. But in my day, I sure was something. Before I felt the heavy hand of time. I'm an old man now, bound for glory. Time to lay these burdens down. Had enough of this old world worry. Gonna trade my troubles for a crown. I will make my way across the fields of cotton and wade through muddy waters one last time. And in my dreams I come out clean when I reach the other side, west of where the sun sets.
Friday, my dudes.
Good morning. I'm here.
Wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Wake up!
What is dark matter?
Okay, we don't know.
That's great. That's why it's called dark.
It's exactly.
Everyone knows all reputable information comes from random people on the internet. Tell me things, internet. The earth is flat. It's like school in your head.
Dark matter is something we do not know what it is. We believe the dark matter is there, but we have never detected it.
Well, what I'm afraid of course, is that there is no dark matter out there.
There was one?
There is no dark matter out there. We need to think really hard, to think really hard.
This is Michael Tyson. You probably know me better as I Am Mike, but I don't go by I Am Mike no more because I used to be a monster. I'm a different person now. I'm all about happiness. But what is happiness? I'll tell you what happiness is. Every time I listen to my favorite show, Iron Realm Media. It's a truther show on YouTube.
And a happy Friday to you all. Welcome to the IronWorX right here, freeworld.fm. You can find us also on YouTube, the Iron Realm Media YouTube channel. Man, TGIF. That's all I got to say. Good morning, gentlemen. How in the hell you doing?
Howdy.
Howdy.
Guten Tag.
Hello.
What's up, Luca?
Uncle Laleco from the Peanut Gallery. Good morning, sir. How are
you? He was asking. Oh, I'm sorry. He was asking what that song was, and I was about to ask the same question, good sir.
That was a song called Where Rainbows Never Die by a band called The Steel Drivers.
Where Rainbows Never Die.
Yeah, it's a pretty good one. They got a couple real good ones. I do kind of like them. The Steel Drivers.
Sweet. I'll cool. Check it out later.
Yeah, I wrote it down, actually, so I can check it out later.
How are you doing, Uncle Laleco? You're not washed away from a giant tidal wave off the coast, are you? You've not seen...
I listened to that show yesterday about the tidal wave. No, no such thing, eh? Although other days I wish it would just come.
Yeah, I can appreciate that.
How is everybody doing?
Oh, you know, as good as can be expected.
In the middle of almost World War III.
There was one?
Almost.
Almost. We shall see.
Yeah, we shall, unfortunately.
So do you guys down there in South Africa hear about the U.S. military on the continent of Africa?
No, they don't report it in the mainstream. You sort of have to look for yourself. I mean, there are other semi-mainstream channels that will sort of report the half-truth, but you sort of have to look for yourself. The main media will not report something like that.
Yeah, it blew my mind when my brother, he was military for 24 years. He told me we have over 30 military bases on the continent of Africa.
No, I knew that. I knew you guys have a lot of military bases. You have a military base even here in South Africa. So I knew that. But I mean, in terms of being active, like physically active, instead of just providing weapons to certain regimes or groups or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say, I don't think the military itself is necessarily so active, but I think the CIA is probably pretty fucking active there.
Yeah.
As much as the presence China has.
I mean, they reported to the U.S., I think it was last year, when Russia, China, and South Africa did testing of their subs, and they were firing rockets from their subs and whatever. And there was reported to the U.S., then the U.S. came out saying something, and I just thought, I mean, it's none of your damn business. We're not firing at you. It's our own coastline. We can do whatever the hell we want.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also one of those things where China comes in and invests a few $100 million in some of these areas, putting in wells and highways and roads and houses and infrastructure. Being like, look at all this great stuff we got you. Now, aren't you going to help us? Because we need batteries.
They have their own police station in one of the provinces.
Yeah.
They actually have their own police station.
They have that in New York City. They had their own police station that they were getting in trouble for running.
That's insane.
Isn't that insane?
I'd like to see just one of those Chinamen try to stop me doing something.
Yeah, I'd like to find just one Chinaman.
Yeah, well, we just have a lot of foreigners. In terms of the foreigners, we are a little bit like the U.S. Well, in Africa, obviously. Everybody wants to come down here for job opportunities and that kind of thing. So we have a lot of illegal, you guys say illegal aliens. What did I say? Why is everyone quiet?
We're just...
You shut us down with that one, bro. No, I had a story pop up in chat that I was going to go kind of peruse, so I got a bit sidetracked. Coffee hadn't kicked in yet, so you know it's getting there. But Post posted a story I will get to in a moment. Thank you, Post.
Yeah, let me ask you guys something. Mm-hmm. So in our towns, the CBD, you know, with all the skyscrapers and buildings and that kind of thing, all the small businesses when I was growing up, I'm talking about 1999, early 2000s, where I was like 12, and like early teenagers, 2004, that kind of thing. Our towns were run by locals. By locals, I mean South Africans. And they had all these shops, like if you were selling fruits or veggies or clothes or cell phone equipment, that kind of thing. All the smaller shops and even the food shops were all from people from this country. And I looked at it even 5 years ago. If you walk through the CBD, all of the shops now, all of the small shops, I'm not talking about big businesses like freaking McDonald's and stuff like that, not that, but like all the unique small shops are all owned by foreigners. By foreigners, I mean Chinese people, Pakistani people, Nigerians, Malawians, Sudanese, Zimbabweans. There's not, I actually work from this one main road from beginning to the end, and there are no South African shops. Like it's all foreigner based. And I was wondering if that's something that happens in any of your towns, one of the big commercial areas.
Not so much here. I know a lot of the, we have a lot of people from India that buy a lot of shops here in South Carolina. And then we actually have a large Russian population here in the Spartanburg area. It never really dawned on me. It dawned on me yesterday, and I, because there's a couple different Russian, I don't want to, like a supermarket. There's a couple of them. You go in there and everything is from Russia, like everything. And then yesterday I heard Jaren and I went to the grocery store and I heard three people talking and they were speaking Russian. And it dawned on me, I was like, wow, we do have a rather large, because I've heard of Russian people around here before. And we have a rather large Russian population compared to anywhere else I've been. Do you guys have any Russians that live down there in Louisiana, Walter?
I mean, I don't know of a pocket of people that are set up, you know, and have continued on their community or anything like that. Not that I know of anywhere near me. Not maybe, you know, in New Orleans, maybe in Baton Rouge, a lot bigger areas might have, you know, their version of Little Russia or whatever, but it's not a thing I know about or have heard about or could access easily. That being said, I mean, the whole state is based on people who migrated from Canada and came down because they were being driven out and settled here, that kind of thing too, you know. So it's like a lot of French based everything here because of that.
I know, so there's that, a lot of Mexicans and then a lot of Greeks, a lot of Greek people up around the Chicagoland area. A lot of good restaurants up there, man, good food. Yeah, it's weird around here, Nuka. It's like, yeah, we're all immigrants pretty much. So we have like pockets and then they spread out and whatnot. I bet if you asked like 50 years ago, it would have been a lot more pocketed and not so spread out. Like I grew up, I was born and lived the first 4 years of my life in Whiting, Indiana. And it was pretty much called Little Poland, pretty much. It was mostly Polish people. And they made the best pierogies. They had the pierogi festival there.
And our people are okay with that, having these pockets of different people having their own stores and own shops and that kind of thing in a country that's technically not their own.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah.
We're not here. I mean, if everybody wanted to go to the, you know, we would all be making Native American Indian food if that was the case, you know?
I just wonder if you would feel that way if the local people, for these Russians and Polish and whatever, to come and own a store and all of that, the local people needed to have been bought out and they lost their businesses so these businesses could open and prosper and whatnot. Because we have a lot of animosity. Not per se people who are, you know, middle class and sort of well off, they generally don't give a shit. But like the poor people definitely have a big issue with all of these foreigners owning things and technically not really paying tax. And because part of the reason they do that, the local people don't own the stores anymore is because, you know, if you open a business, it was your thing. Maybe you and your family, you put some money together, you rent out a space and, you know, you sell whatever it is that you're selling. But these people, when they come, there's so many of them that they all pull their money together. They don't have homes to go to or upkeep, so they live in their shops. They drive out the local people in terms of pricing them. And then they're the ones that end up getting a monopoly on certain things that they're the ones selling, and they live in their shops. And then they get all their money and send it home, wherever home is, so their families can also prosper. And it, I know it grains the teeth of some of the locals because we have to pay tax and all of that stuff, yet they are benefiting from the country and aren't really contributing to the country. Everything they make, they try to send back home to benefit like another country. So I know we're having elections in a month's time, so that's going to be one of the big talking points for the political parties.
Yeah, there's certain laws against like living in your business. I know in Indiana they arrested a guy. That's how they got rid of him, because he had a head shop. You know, like he sold smoking pipes and stuff like that, and all the cool t-shirts and the, you know, hippie music and all that kind of stuff, the tie-dyed stuff. And they didn't want him to be in town, in city limits of Valparaiso. And he was sleeping in his shop. And that was one of the, an old law or something like that, one of the town things, is that you weren't allowed to sleep in a place of business. You could have a residence up above it, but it couldn't be in the same, like... So, yeah, there's... I'm sure there's animosity from the store owners and stuff like that when a new business owner comes into town from, you know, especially a foreigner. But as far as the people, I can't say that, because... there is, you know, there's racism in this country. But like me growing up and everything like that, we never saw the, at least, I don't know, not for my family or my mom. You know, if we went into a shop and it was one of my favorite shops was called Hobart Euros. It was this Greek guy named Dino and his family. I remember my buddy's dad would not allow him to eat there. Don't know why. Don't know what he had against Greek people. I never heard anybody being racist towards Greek people. But his dad wouldn't let him eat there. We don't need all these foreigners bringing their shops into towns, blah, 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 blah. So yeah, there were people like that, but it was a lot fewer and far between that I saw, at least growing up. What about you, Jared, Josh, and...
Well, St. Louis is like smack dab in the middle of the country, so we've always had a pretty decent population of immigrants, one way or the other. They do tend to be a little pocketed.
Have their own little towns, pretty much.
Yeah, or little neighborhoods, really. And I can appreciate that. I would think that there's probably a good chance that were I to go and expat somewhere, I could foresee, well, maybe not me, but somebody would want to sort of identify and surround themselves with some familiarity, as in similar culture, similar language, and things like that. And maybe as an expatriate may not be a good example, as like an immigrant, where you're sort of thrust in somewhere and it's all sort of new and unplanned and unexpected, and you're just kind of stuck there. Similar like with Hurricane Katrina, when it just displaced everybody and they just had to relocate all around the country. Like, you would find people from Louisiana sort of gathered together because that's what was familiar. So I can appreciate that. When it comes to the large national scale, I do have a bit of an issue with people not really willing to adapt and integrate. And this is the problem with the open borders, really. I think you see it all across Europe, where they just basically opened the borders, and now you've got all these immigrants coming in, and they just said, well, we can just... It gives them the opportunity to just take over. And if you're going to give, say, here in America, let's just throw out a number, say 14 million people that come across the border and just say, here's an ID. Now you've got an identification for this country, which is really all you need to vote. So now you've got 14 million immigrants voting for what happens to 380 million citizens. And it's just, when you are still sort of centralized and you run, say, little Poland, and you've got 14 million people of Polish descent voting, they're going to be voting for those interests. Or the interests of just completely allowing all of the rest of Poland into America. And this is just an example, but...
I have a question about the structure of your voting system. Okay, so say all of us here, Walter, yourself, everyone, lives in a specific town, and the population of that town is maybe, let's say, 100,000 people. Right. So how would the voting in terms of national voting, I don't know if you have separate, because in my country it's separate. So we have many political parties. So for my town, so we're living in this town that's 100,000 people. I can vote for, say, Walter, who belongs in a totally different party than myself, to be mayor of our town because, number one, he lives here. We can always go to him and he can do the job or whatever. But for national, for who runs the actual country, I can still vote for somebody else, like the political party that I subscribe to, versus to the town that I live in.
So because we have so many different small municipalities that require votes, and then you have large counties where those municipalities, those little towns sit, like the larger counties, then all of those counties will make up the state, then all of those states will make up the country, and each one of those levels has their own sort of voting system, not necessarily system, but specific rules. So some states, they might do it all at once. Some states might do some of the local stuff, then they do federal voting at a different time. Because it's all state run, each state sort of has its right to set rules however they see fit. Like, they can run their primaries whenever they want. They can run all that shit. A lot of times it's just constitutionalized in the per state. But yeah, it's really it's almost impossible to keep track of the entire country and their voting schedule and rules.
You only get to vote once for whatever political party that you subscribe to. You can't vote for an individual for your town and then
it's all individualized. It's
possible. Yeah, it's all. Like, we could vote for different parties on the same, like, for the mayor, I may want to vote for a Democrat, but for the governor, I want to vote Republican. Mm-hmm. Or this, you can pick individual, whoever you want. You don't have to stick with a party.
Oh, that's interesting.
But you can. They also do straight party ticket votes where you can just say, I want Republicans, so every Republican that's running, I want to vote for them, or every Democrat that's running, I want to vote for them.
And I'm sorry, those votes, in my opinion, should be thrown in the garbage. Just saying. May sound horrible, but hey, that's just an uneducated vote for my team. I'm on this team. They don't care what people say, who they are. They just think that they're supposed to vote this way because this is how mom and dad taught me to vote. And I would rather watch TV than go and actually listen to these people speak or read something that they wrote. So I'm a Democrat. So I'm just going to vote Democrat on everything. I don't care who it is. And that's how our country's gotten into this.
I'm with you there. I'm with you there because in our country too, they're voting for the current ruling party and they've basically finished all of our assets, and it's badly run, and you know it's going down. That's why we have things like load shedding, the rolling blackouts. Every now and then now we're getting, they say that they're fixing the pipeline for the water, but I think it's a bunch of hogwash. They've messed that up too. And you know, it's hard to for people who still remember how it was in the apartheid regime to change their minds and vote for somebody else instead of the ruling party, because that was the party that freed them, which was a big thing. And the same thing was installed to their children. And see, I'm born in 1990. Technically, I was born before democracy in this country, but I was young enough to never have known the bloody difference. By the time we got freedom, I was 4 years old, or 3.5, or whatever it was. And as far as I can remember, we have been free. But technically, you know, we weren't when I was born. And it's hard for people to vote for a different party, even though they can see that the ruling party has squandered all of our assets and everyone is suffering and no one's really thriving in the country anymore, but then because they're being corrupt and stealing all the money. I don't see how you can change that until you have maybe totally, totally new generation. Maybe 50 years down the line, that might change.
Yeah. Or you have, like what you had in Russia in the late 80s, you know, complete collapse of your government. And they say, what, about every 250 years, no government system? I mean, of course, countries have lasted, you know, according to his story, over 250 years. But actual government systems of control, like right now we have a republic, you know, and you have monarchies and blah, 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 and this and that. And those are always changing. The types of governments that are ruling, you know, over the land, that changes. But it takes a long time for it to happen. Not always. Not always. But, yeah.
There's a story I want to go over when we get back from the other side of the break. I saw it yesterday. I think it was even last night after I got home. That's going to fit.
I will remind you.
Right in with this ending of governments and countries and all that good stuff. But we'll just
take a music.
Start small, think big. Ain't no other better way to live. If you think big, start small.
You ain't gotta have a lot to have it all. Slow it down, take your time, cause the sun shines on us all. Start small and think big, y'all. Everybody wants a whole lot of money in their pocket. Big house, a big car, a big boat, a big rocket. More money, more problems, but more money can't solve them. Everybody's in a hurry, get to God knows where. Then they worry about what they're gonna do when they get there. I've been there before, but I've learned more and more. You gotta start small and think big. Ain't no other better way to live. If you think big and start small, you ain't gotta have a lot to have it all. Slow it down, take your time, cause the sun shines on us all. Start small and think big, y'all. I could worry about tomorrow, but why? I could kick it on the beach, so why not? When I'm with you, I'm in heaven in the treetops. It can't get any better than what we got. So start small and think big. Ain't no other better way to live. If you think big and start small, you ain't gotta have a lot to have it all. Slow it down, take your time, cause the sun shines on us all. Start small and think big, y'all. Easy come and easy go. Easy does it nice and slow. Easy come and easy go. Easy does it nice and slow. Easy come and easy go. Easy does it nice and slow. Easy come and easy go. Throw your hands in the sky, let me know about it, yo. Everybody's in a hurry, get to God knows where. Then they worry about what they're gonna do when they get there. I've been there before, but I ain't there anymore. I'm gonna start small, think big. Ain't no other better way to live. If you think big and start small, you ain't gonna have a lot to have it all. Slow it down, take your time, cause the sun shines on us all. Start small and think big, y'all. Easy come and easy go. Easy does it nice and slow. Easy come and easy go. Easy does it nice and slow. Easy come and easy go. Easy does it nice and slow. Easy come and easy go. Throw your hands in the sky, let me know about it, yo. Start small and think big. Ain't no other better way to live. If you think big and start small, you ain't gotta have a lot to have it all.
And welcome back. Second half of the first half of the IRONWORX. Kick it off right here, right now. Freeworld.fm. Little Michael Franti and Spearhead. Start small. Think big. Yep.
We're waiting for the story.
No story. I got nothing. Just a good little song.
Which everybody liked in chat, by the way.
Oh, good.
I think you should start putting the names and the artists of these songs in chat as you play it.
Yeah, I do sometimes. The trouble is, once I play this song, it's because it's break time. And break time for me means trying to slowly but surely get ready for work in 5-minute increments or as long as the song is. So I press play and I'm gone. Like, I don't even listen to the song.
Ah, I see.
Then I just try to get back before it's over with varying results.
I think we need a new DJ.
Mm.
DJ Walty.
Yeah, we tried that. My system and getting music out just, it apparently isn't intended to happen. I have tried every way I can to present music the way Josh does, with fake virtual cables, and I'll have a whole new setup twice over now, and yeah, it just never does sound right. for me doing it. It just, I don't know what the deal is. But yeah, definitely. You just get you some earbuds, wireless earbuds, Josh, and you can jam the whole day long.
Just got to beam that Bluetooth right to both of my ears. I'm sure whatever happens in the middle will be fine. Be fine.
Do we have a special guest for tonight?
I don't. I'm sure hoping Walter comes in with something out of the clear blue.
No. Well, unfortunately, Walter's week didn't let that happen.
Yeah.
It's been all about the cat. I know you guys are so tired of hearing me whine about my cat fun, but we finally had to take the outside cat who has recently had kittens. Nacho is her name. She's the one that got put out because she freaked out on the first or the second set of litter or whatever. Anyway, so she had her litter and they said, wait till she wasn't nursing them anymore, and they've been on solid food for quite a while now, the three kittens she had. And every now and again I would go outside and see them, you know, at her teats, but they it wasn't like a constant, you know, that more was like at night going to sleep, kind of a comfort thing it felt like. And so as that kept being less and less, and I literally would find her laying outside, you know, totally away from them, and they're all bundled up on their own sleeping. So I figured it was that time because we had the appointment pre-made. I couldn't get Rizzo inside in the car crate. So I went and checked her again, and she, like, all her mammaries all seemed not swollen anymore. Everything seemed good. Took her up there and, you know, explained the situation to them. They said, yeah, it'll be fine. Even if she is still lactating, we can still do the surgery. You just have to be careful afterward with the kittens, because if they try to nurse on her, they can cause issues with the, you know, sutures and internal sutures and all that. So that meant we had to bring her inside to our room. And she hasn't been an inside cat in almost a year and a half now. We're going on a good year. And so she's in our room. Now, don't get me wrong. She still wants to come into the main house. She still gets to the door and she still acts like she wants to be in here. But now that she's in here, she's like, no, let me out. Where are my kittens? I don't live in here anymore. We had to put a pool noodle under the door kind of to keep them from all the out. You know, the inside cats are all hissing at the door crack because they know she's in here and they're all flipping out because I guess they have that instinctive, like, either this strange cat in the house or maybe they could remember what happened. Michelle said she's read they don't have much memory on that kind of stuff. I don't agree, but anyway. So yeah, it's been a whole thing. I mean, not getting any sleep for two nights straight. Literally for the first two nights she was in the room, it was nothing but meow 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 till she made herself hoarse, which makes me feel terrible, you know, because I realized that, you know, I'm doing what I'm doing for her good and all of that, but it still doesn't make it feel any better when she's stressed out because she needs to be with her kittens and she can't get out and she's freaking out. And so, yeah, it's been a whole thing. Last night is literally the first night I slept through without getting woken up at least 17, 18 times with her meowing at the door. So that being said, she did finally settle in on the bed with us enough last night to totally attack my feet and toes when I turned over. So I'm all scratched up this morning. But yeah, that's been my week. It's dealing with her, trying to get her back into a normal state so that she doesn't flip out on us in the bedroom and throw us in the night while we're sleeping. But she's calmed down now. Like I said, last night she slept through. She didn't start making noise till my clock went off, the first one. And she took up her course yet again. So we're going to get her out there probably by this, like, next day or so, though, because we have to get back to a normal life. So by that time, the sutures, even though they could still, you know, to come loose, they should be more secure, and it all should work out anyway, because we can't do this much longer. Anyway, so, yeah, I haven't called or made any attempts. I have, like, four tabs I'm looking at on my computer right now that are people I intend to reach out to, and one of which I did get into one of the chats of their videos and mention us, but I didn't get an email yet, and I haven't checked the Iron Realm email this week, so we'll see what happens. But yeah, it's been a cat week.
That sounded so exhausting.
It's, yeah, it is. It is. It definitely gets that way. And I love them all. That's, you know, I wouldn't go through this if I didn't. Believe me, I wouldn't be going through any of this if I didn't love these cats fully. And, like, they have my heart and my soul, so.
You see a lot of electric
today
down there?
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, Walter, go ahead.
No, I was just saying, today is a new day to start again. I agree. Waking up early is the cheat code to life. I just wish I could do it in a better mood. So, what were you going to say, Zach?
I was going to ask Nuka if the whole electric vehicle thing has hit South Africa.
No. We sometimes don't have power. We have load shedding.
Right.
Imagine now you need to charge your car and you don't have power. No. It hasn't really.
Just park it around the town well. Oh, wait.
Fellas, I do remember there was a... I don't know if it was last week or this week, the talk about the solar eclipse. Did we get any cool footage?
That's one thing I'm planning.
Oh, yeah, Austin.
Yeah, we got a lot of cool
Austin.
Images from people.
Yeah.
Austin, Karen.
Speaking of cool footage, have you heard from Brendan, Josh, about what he
was able
to catch or kept?
I've not heard anything.
I was thinking about that yesterday. Yeah, we need to reach out and see what he found, what he got, what he, you know. He may have had the cloud cover, though, where he was. I never did look up at the weather to see what it was like where he was. So.
Well, he's up north, right?
He is.
Yeah.
He was going to go up to maybe Niagara or something there at the border, I think, and check it out. Maybe further up north now that I think about it.
Some images from that part of the country. I need some, that astronomy live guy. He's a glober. And I'm about 90% certain that he pulled a Soundly and he faked getting the craters of the moon during the eclipse.
Yeah, what was the next question? So what was covering the moon?
Yeah, I don't know. But yeah,
Ketu, Rahu, the moon. I mean, the sun. What was covering the sun?
Yeah, he's got a picture where it's showing the moon features. You know, you can see like craters and stuff like that during the eclipse. The moon that's on there isn't the moon he should be looking at that time of day from his position on Earth. Like the moon, a lot of people don't realize this, but the moon, like to the east and to the west, looks different. To the south, it always looks the same for everybody. But if you're looking to the east, it's going to look different than if you're looking at it towards the west, because it does the wagon wheel throughout the day while it's traversing the sky. It rotates due to perspective. And this guy didn't take that into account. So he had it looking like it was just rising to the east. And there's no way it looked like that during an eclipse, because an eclipse happens midday.
Well, Liz says, I think you have to have a membership to see Crow 777 eclipse footage.
Yeah, I heard he didn't find anything spectacular. He didn't go to totality.
I didn't even know that guy was still going.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Crow777radio.com. First hour is free.
Still, huh?
Yeah, he just quit doing it on YouTube because of the censorship.
Okay. Yeah, I was just interested in see if we caught some cool things. I've stopped trying to explain to people that it's not the moon covering the sun. I've just decided to stop.
Yeah, because, I mean, we can't really prove it one way or the other, you know? That's why I keep trying to get people to...
Look, I always say to people, sometimes you see the moon during the day, and you can literally see the sky behind the damn thing. I mean, it looks translucent blue because the sky is blue. So how is that thing all of a sudden so black that it can cover up the sun when the sky you can see through it? Anyway.
Yeah, it's a good point. But again, you're asking people to think logically and critically there, Nuka. I don't know how that works there in Africa, but it doesn't work too well here.
Well, it doesn't help that we also have a lot of dumb people anyway. The logic part of things is not working. They get taught to find the answers, not to understand the question and find the answer yourself.
Speaking of dumb people, have you heard about the Cybertruck? The new kerfuffle? Yeah, it's got another nemesis, a new nemesis now. A car wash.
Bum, bum, bum.
Don't take your Tesla Cybertruck through the car wash, even when it's in car wash mode, because it will void the warranty.
Even in its...
No,
wait, in what?
Yes, there is car wash mode.
And it voids the warranty if you take it in there.
Caused by car washes is not covered by the warranty. Even a car wash was able to defeat the 6,600-pound pickup. A routine visit through a car wash to get sand off the truck after a beach visit seemingly caused the entire vehicle to shut down. Curiosity into a giant brick.
Isn't that oxymoronic, though? To get a truck to go to the beach and do, like... truck things, but get an electric truck.
Yeah, it even says to not wash it, your Tesla Cybertruck, in direct sunlight. Like, if you go to wash it. Direct sunlight.
No, you're pulling my leg now.
No, I swear to God. What? It's like, what? Why can't I wash
my
truck?
You can't wash it in direct sunlight, too?
No.
Well, you see, water droplets make little tiny magnifying glasses, don't you know? And that amazingly bulletproof paint job.
And that water pressure might bust all the windows out. You know, the bulletproof glass.
Okay, how much is this car?
Oh, they're expensive. Okay, and to reboot it, he had to reboot it, right? He had to hold down two buttons the night before. But the reboot required 5 hours to complete. So while it was rebooting, he had no idea that it was rebooting. He just woke up and it was back to normal, and he was like, okay.
They started 81,895. It can go up to $101,985.
$81,000
to start.
That's where they start.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Baseball.
And it even warns you.
I want to see how much that is in my currency.
Well, it's the base model probably doesn't even have car wash mode.
No, probably not.
You're just stuck with the dirty truck.
The windows.
They just send you a dirty t-shirt when you head out. So here, use this.
But not in direct sunlight.
That's 1.5 million rands. Hell no.
And if you do want to go through a car wash, it has to be a touchless car wash that don't make contact with the Cybertruck surface.
What?
This thing is rugged, let me tell you. Oh my goodness. Failure to put that in.
I'm starting to think if a butterfly sits on this thing, it might crack the windscreen.
Damages caused by improper washing is also not covered, and it tells you not to wash it in direct sunlight.
Okay, but now how can they prove you washed it in direct sunlight?
Water spots.
I don't know.
Because, I mean, you could be driving, there's direct sunlight, and if it starts raining a little bit, I mean...
No.
They can't prove that.
You better pull your ass over.
No driving in the rain.
No driving in the rain. Unless it's going to rain forever. If you're in Seattle and it just rains forever, you're fine.
No. What do you mean no driving in the rain now?
Well, it has to stay... It has to be wet. if it stays raining, you're fine. It's it's when the sun comes out and you've got a wet truck and sunlight that you're just fucked. You just wasted $100,000 on a truck because you got it wet. It's a motherfucking gremlin. Don't get it wet. Don't feed it after midnight.
Who made this club?
Avoid sunlight. Yeah.
Okay, so follow these steps when you're going to wash your Cybertruck. Before washing, you flush the grime and the grit from the vehicle using a hose. You flush away accumulations of mud in areas where debris easily collects, such as wheel wells and panel seams. If salt has been used on highways, such as during winter months, thoroughly rinse all traces of road salt from the underside of the vehicle, wheel wells, and brakes. Mix a mild pH neutral soap, such as the car shampoo, with the water until it gets soapy, and then use a soft sponge in a soap mixture and hand wash your Cybertruck. Now, caution. Some cleaners, this is a big, like, yellow caution sign. Some car cleaners and shampoos contain chemicals that can cause damage and discoloration for plastic trim. Plastic? Wait, what? Blah, blah, blah. Basically, damage, discoloration, etc. This whole article is coming from Tesla.com, and it is talking about how you clean your little precious vehicle and how the fact is it doesn't have any type of outer coating on it, and any scratches are going directly into the metal panels, and how it is normal for stainless steel exterior to mature over time, resulting in minor changes to the relative reflective properties and color of the metal. So yeah, you're going to have a shitty looking vehicle here in about a year. They literally tell you in this article to stop as soon as you get a grease, oil, bird droppings, tree resin, dead insects, tar spot, any corrosive substance. Don't wait until your truck is due for a complete wash. Get it off immediately. If necessary, use denatured alcohol to remove tar spots and stubborn grease stains. Then immediately wash that area with a mild non-detergent soap to remove the alcohol. So it's apparently alcohol can fuck it up easily too. Yeah, this is like the most ridiculous shit I've ever seen in my life.
Like a luxury sports car.
I'm looking at pictures of this thing. It looks kind of cool, but
not in any way. No, I mess with you.
That looks cool to me. It's just going to break though as soon as you buy it.
Yeah, it's not a pickup truck.
I'd consider an internal combustion version. Get me a regular truck, maybe with some four-wheel drive, you know, maybe some nice high-end
torque.
Oh, my
God.
Maybe throw it there with that body on top of it, maybe. But that body combined with that motor and the fact that water is dangerous.
And take a ton and a half the weight.
Wait. This is a list of official cautions for exterior cleaning at Tesla.com I am now sharing. And if you look here where my pointer is, caution. Do not aim water hoses directly at windows, door or hood seals, or at any electronic modules or exposed
cables. See, then how's gonna wash it?
Told you.
Ensure the wipers are off before washing the Cybertruck. Yeah, well, that's basic stuff there. Do not use chemicals. Oh, my God. Don't use a rough cloth. Avoid using tight napped or rough cloths such as washing mitts. A high quality microfiber cleaning cloth is recommended. Yeah, but whatever you do, don't aim water at the window.
This is a city.
Oh, you can't use windshield treatment fluids in your cleaning. It will interfere with wiper friction, cause a chattering sound.
Yeah, this is New York City pickup truck right here. This is your L.A. pickup truck. You know, you park it in a parking garage and have somebody, you know, buff it for you every day. Because this is – guys who drive pickup trucks don't go out there and, oh, look, there's a little bit of tar right there on my thing. I better get out the thing and –
Yeah, I don't think you can buff this truck. You try to buff this truck, the bumper might fall off.
I can't wait. Is this going to be the next DeLorean? Do you think? It'll be around for a couple years, and then they're going to be like, yeah, we're just not going to do this anymore.
I feel like all electric vehicles are going to be the next DeLorean. And just,
yeah.
They'll be sitting around, but nobody's going to drive them. Like, oh, yeah, that thing. Remember when we thought that would be cool?
Remember when we thought this was a good idea? We were going to save the planet by driving electric vehicles, but we're still charging them with coal-powered energy sources. And it takes more. You burn more fuel to charge the car than you would if you just ran a combustion engine. So no, they overshot way too early. It's a great theory. It's a great idea.
Well, hold on. I remember seeing an article about a long, I can't remember the exact date, but like a long time ago that they had electric vehicles, the proper electric vehicles, and they could last, one charge could last for a whole week or something.
Well, that's by, you know, a design that isn't, you know, designed to make everybody poor.
And I bet you, I'm sure you get at least a few weeks out of a charge on any electric vehicle. Every electric vehicle will probably hold a charge for a few weeks.
But driving it, you know.
Oh, yeah, driving it, you're fucked. If you drive it, you're going to last maybe a day. But you want to charge it and park it, that's just going to last.
They had the estimation in miles and stuff where it was pretty far. But so if they had that technology back then, why are the cars now so shit?
Good question.
Why indeed?
Sure, you know, the weight was a lot different. I don't know. Actually, I don't know. I have no clue. I could make up a bunch of shit right now. But yeah, I don't know. I heard they used to run a lot better too. I've seen patents for cars that ran on ether, they said. It pulled the electricity like from the charge from the air.
That sounds cool.
I don't know if it even worked. I have no clue. But it was someone applied for a patent for it. I don't know if it ever got through. Those patent office files are crazy. You can find some really wild, crazy stuff in there.
Oh.
Do you guys have a patent office that you can go and look through there? In South Africa, Nuka?
Yeah, we do. We do. It's online as well. You just sort of go on their websites and look for it. Even registering businesses, you just do it online now.
How is that in like your public works offices? Like if you go to, can you still go into a building to pay your water bill and your electricity bill? And
you can. You can do that, but you know, the system might be down. That's the famous line I like using.
Do it online, come back another day.
I mean, it's you just rather do it online. It's easier online because online it's more the banking institutions take charge instead of being able to pay online, and they're always working properly because
always,
it's
that's
money,
right? Yeah. They'll always accept the money.
Right. You can't send
I always say the best government institution that works always, every time in my country is SARS, and that's the tax department.
Now, is your tax department a private bank, or is it federally owned? Like, is it ran by the government? Or is it like ours, where we have a private bank?
I want to say it's ran by the government, but I don't actually know. I'm going to look now.
Well, you look that up. We're going to take a little break. We have hit that time. Yeah, it flew through there. Thanks for hanging out with us this morning, everybody. This is the IronWorX on freeworld.fm. Stick around. We've got more coming up.
If you haven't
right after this.
I feel bad for your son. I got 99 problems and a bitch ain't one.
We'll do it live! Fuck it! I can, I'll write it and we'll do it live. Right. Fucking thing sucks.
Good morning. I'm here.
Wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Wake up!
What is dark matter?
Okay, we don't know.
That's great. That's why it's called dark.
It's exactly.
Everyone knows all reputable information comes from random people on the internet. Tell me things, internet. The earth is flat. It's like school in your hand.
Dark matter is something we do not know what it is. We believe the dark matter is there, but we have never detected it.
Well, I'm afraid of course, it is there is no dark matter out there.
There was one?
There is no dark matter out there. We need to think really hard. To think really hard.
And welcome back. First half of the second half of the IRONWORX kicking off right now. That's hour number two. Freeworld.fm. You can find us on YouTube as well. Iron Realm Media channel. Make sure you're subbed. They like to unsub us. We still haven't hit that. What was it? 45, 50, I forget. It's like 45, 45 is the max. We just can't seem to get over. We're down to like 45, 39 or some shit. It's like just one little threshold that YouTube doesn't want us to get over with our subs.
Yeah, I remember that. I was stuck right around there for the longest time. Then I was stuck at like 1600 for the longest time. And yeah, there's a few different spots where they're like, yeah, we're just going to stop you right here for a while. Look at Jaron. He's been at like 153,000 for 7 years. And they have not let his sub count go up at all. And Flat Earth just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. Yeah, it's crazy.
It doesn't feel as big anymore.
Well, I think
that's because you've integrated it into your worldview. To me, that's what I feel like, Nuka. It is just the world you live in now. It's not the it was those first few years. And so, yeah. That's how it feels for me anyway. It's just my life now. That just is the world I'm in.
But you gotta remember that we still have so much more to discover. You know what I mean? Like, even for me, looking at the moon right now, like, I'm discovering stuff about the moon.
Oh, absolutely. That's why I get so excited when things like your footage and, like, the histories, you know, Tartaria, all the new things that have come along since, I've settled into the fact that, yeah, I'm not flying through a fucking infinite void on a cinder of fucking, you know, spark that's imminently going to be dashed apart. All that crap they had us believe in, all that's gone, and my life is so much better because of it. So it just makes those new discoveries and those new revelations, that's not the word, but the things that we see, yeah, that's it. Yeah, they definitely are easier to both discern and to come across, I guess, to me anyway. It's just settled in and part of me. That's.
I had a couple of writers earlier, so I wasn't able to jump in. But you know, I'll just reiterate that I'm thinking that the whatever the moon is, you know, it is a polarizing light that when it's held up against the sun, those two lights create that dark body. I mean, you know. That's the word. Yeah, that's where I'm at with it right now.
Polaroid filters.
Say again.
Like Cami and her Polaroid filters. She'll show you that.
Exactly. Yeah. 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 She blew my mind. When she did that, I was like, oh my God, that's amazing. You know what I mean? But it's just shit that is out there, and you know, but you don't know about it, or you don't look at it in a certain light, and when you see it, look at it in another light, you're like, oh my God, that's amazing.
That's why I want one of those solar filters with the hydrogen double stack. I want to go out there and, because when Chris was here with that and he was focused on the second sun, a Polaroid filter, a man-made one, when we would rotate it in front of it, it would eclipse that second sun. And it wouldn't just blacken it out, but it would start from one side and cover it like a circular disc shape, just like an eclipse.
Yeah, that's why I'm convinced that we should be able to mimic some of this stuff that we think about or I'm saying about the moon. You know, if we could create this container, so to speak, that had fluorescent gas or whatever it is that you use for fluorescence, and then you try to excite it and see how you can manipulate it. You know, and it's kind of like, you know, how the old magnet games that we used to play with the wands that had the magnet tip and you could drag the filings all around. And that's what the light's going to do. The light's going to follow that charge.
I would love a super dome, a hermetically sealed size, like super dome.
Two men enter, one man leaves.
But yeah, where I get to put in the gases, I get to control the electric field in there, the magnetic, you know, like your own terrarium of Earth. I would love something big where you could actually see the manipulations happening that you're doing. Because on a really small scale, a lot of the stuff might be going on and you might not be even seeing it happen. To excite the gases inside there, you're going to excite all the gas inside there. It won't just be the upper layer or this or that. It's too small of an area. I think we need a very large container.
Yeah. I mean, I was just thinking about how, you know, you can have a fluorescent bulb, you know, the long ones, and then part of it goes out, but the other part stays charged and you can see, you know, half of it's lit.
Yeah. I mean, I can do that with my Tesla coil.
Right.
You know, depending on where I grab that bulb and ground it out. Like, I can make a quarter of the bulb lit real bright and the rest would all be black. But yeah, to have something real big. Could you imagine walking into like a super dome type structure and looking and seeing stars rotating, just floating there in the sky and a sun going around?
You mean you've created an environment where you can do that? Is that what you're saying? Right. And if you walked into that kind of a thing, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I think that.
I mean, but that's no different than just going outside. All you're doing is just reproducing outside inside, right?
Exactly. We're saying this is how the world works.
Yeah. That's the whole thing. You can't fucking demonstrate it. That don't print. You know what I mean? There's no reason to put this out in the press if we can't demonstrate this. Then, you know, but that's not.
Anymore though, Trev. What do they say? 98% plus scientifically, you know, published papers are nonsense. They're not even scientific whatsoever. It's beyond theoretical because it's theory based upon theory based upon theory based upon theory, and they're still getting this nonsense published.
Did you see that kind of like a wannabe beautiful mind movie called The Man Who Can See Infinity?
No.
And it's allegedly about a true story about an Indian man who just was a savant with numbers and symbols and shit. So he traveled to...
Oh, sorry, go ahead. I had heard a story about a young boy from India who found a math book, an old math book, and read through it and then started rewriting math, like how you do. I was wondering if that was based on
him. I don't know. It could have been part of the story and I'm just forgetting it. I mean, or he could be maybe the one that the other found out about. But anyway, it's just when I'm watching it, it's an interesting story, but I'm watching them just solve logical puzzles. You know, it's just like these symbols are just, they have value. That squiggly line has a value, this squiggly, this, that, and the other. Like he's just a computer. He's just crunching numbers in his massive brain. It's not that it's real. You know what I mean? And I'm thinking these people are going to school or this guy's a professor and he's getting paid to just talk about bullshit, just theoretical science.
Yeah.
I wish I could get paid to talk about nothing.
That's why people say, well, what does it matter if it's flat or round or this or that, or if we're being taught wrong? That's where I think it matters most. All this.
Yeah, that's part of it.
Brain power. This brain power that should be spent on figuring out real solutions to real problems. No, they're figuring out solutions on how to equate a quasar with a nebula entering a black hole, you know? Yeah, their brain power is much more valuable than working on Narnia. We need their brains to be figuring out the real problems that are here. Yeah, it's sad.
But they could also be recruited and paid, you know, a shit ton of money to keep the facade going.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm sure.
You know what I mean? Because they don't want, you know, I don't know, whatever. That's, I'm just making that up. I have nothing to justify that per se, except the creative mind from watching, you know, too much Netflix. But I'm on my way to Flatstock.
Nice. I hope the weather is great for you guys this weekend. Yeah, I heard Tommy saying there's already people there hanging out, and they've been jamming all week.
Okay. I had to work all the way up. I just got done doing two rides. So I tried to get a ride out of my county down to the city, and then I got another one out of the city a little bit farther down, so I was able to make a few dollars. And then I thought, I'm not doing this anymore. I'm going to stop working. I'm just going to drive. But it's been an enjoyable show so far. I was cracking up laughing, you guys talking about that Tesla shit. I was just laughing to myself. It was ridiculous. That's just so absurd. So who's our new, I've never heard this guest before. This gentleman from South Africa.
You've never heard.
How have you missed Nuka? Right.
I don't know. It's just not ringing a bell.
I would have swore you guys have spoken. You guys have been on the show before at the same time.
Wait, have you guys ever been in the same room at the same time? Are you guys one person?
Hello, Travis.
Hello. And was it Nuka?
Yeah, we've spoken before, not like directly at each other, but we've been in the room, yeah.
All right, well, I apologize.
Hello, Andrew.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
What's up, Andy?
You don't need any bail money or anything, huh?
Why would I need bail money?
Why wouldn't you, brother?
Well, if people want to give me bail money for something I don't need, I'll probably just decline it. I'm not in prison or anything.
You're a smooth
Knowing you, you'd go do something to end up in jail so you can pay the bail money.
Well, I mean, when I run for president the next election cycle, then I might just get myself arrested just to make, you know, something small, right? You know, like be in jail for like, I don't know, a couple weeks or something like that. And then I'll actually try to like petition, like to run for president. Like, how can they stop you from doing it? Right? It's federal law, apparently. You're allowed to do it.
And then that's why you have a lot of people committing suicide by shooting themselves twice in the head.
Yeah, that's a little off, but.
And that had just happened not too long ago here. The whistleblower from Boeing shot himself twice in the head, apparently.
Oh, yeah. I read about that.
Just after he was getting ready to go back in and testify some more. Yeah.
So, crazy. I don't get this. Like, how is this? So, this is public knowledge, and it's allegedly a suicide?
No, it's confirmed as a suicide. Not allegedly.
Okay, great. Okay, great. Yeah. Okay, great. But allegedly, because there's two gunshot wounds. Right? Okay, so now it's an alleged suicide because we all know that's impossible. But my question is this, like, if this is public knowledge, is there no fucking person out there going, what? This isn't what we're being told because no one can shoot themselves twice.
Oh, yeah.
This isn't a suicide. But no one is.
Sure.
But you've not looked into the Clintons, I take it, Travis.
Yeah, I was gonna say,
I get it. No. I'm not saying I've never heard about it. I'm saying, like, for us, you know, in our conspiratorial circles, we can pull the veil back and see, like, this is another storyline that no one else. But I'm talking about the population out there who sees the same story, and they, I just don't get it.
No, like, I think the population knows. I think when people hear that story, I think most people actually know that it's not a suicide, but it comes down to what are you going to do about it?
Yeah, that's what it is.
But that's what I'm saying, the indifference, right? Like, why are we indifferent? Like, I know. Don't we believe in whatever the Constitution is, whatever the Bill of Rights are, when they say that we have the ability, and what's interesting is, at least in that first text, it doesn't tell us how, but if we aren't happy with the government, it says we have the right to oppose. But it doesn't say how many people.
I believe it says we have the duty.
I don't think it's indifference either.
That's a right. It's your duty.
I don't think it's indifference either. I think, you know, people hear it and it's just like, what am I actually going to do about it? I can't go up against this institution.
That's indifference, in my opinion. That's indifference.
Okay.
Yeah. Because if you're one way or the other, you know, if you're positive, then you're gonna try to do something. I mean, you know.
Well, 95% warfare is not physical. It's information. And that's the war that we're fighting right now. That's what we're doing right now, is fighting this war.
How did you start your sentence? I didn't hear that first part.
95% of warfare is information-based.
Okay.
5% of war is actual fighting and conflict.
Sure,
95%
sure.
of it is what we're doing right now. We're disseminating information to the public
to make
them aware of this stuff and keep it going. Because so many times it does go in one ear and out the other. And the only way you're going to get enough people to do something about it is if there's enough people that are aware of it all at the same time.
Right.
Do you think that would actually happen if a lot of people were aware of it at the same time? People tend to only want to do something if it directly affects them.
This is the rub, I think, the real bitch, is that cognitive dissonance isn't a choice. It's not going, oh man, that's stupid. I'm going to be cognitive dissonant about that. Is that cognitive dissonance sets in whether you like it or not. So you'd be like, oh my God, this guy was investigating the Clintons and he killed himself by shooting himself twice in the head and then stuffing himself into a duffel bag. So, so sad. Like, well, that can't be suicide. Obviously, you don't shoot yourself twice in the head and stuff yourself into a duffel bag posthumously. That just doesn't happen. Obviously, it wasn't a suicide. Well, okay, now cognitive dissonance sets in. Well, shit. The people in charge are openly executing their political rivals and dissidents. Fuck. Now
yeah,
what?
You know what makes me, reminds me of that movie, The Boondock Saints, the very first one, if you guys ever saw it. It's probably one of my top 10 movies I've ever seen. When William Dafoe, he's the detective.
I was just going to say, yeah, William Dafoe, yeah.
Yeah, he's the homicide detective that comes in from the FBI, and he's talking about how they're trying to rule out a suicide, even though the guy got shot in the back of the head twice. And yeah, he's like, oh yeah, you wouldn't cock your arm. They were trying to figure out if it was one shooter or two shooters. But like, oh yeah, you wouldn't cock your arms out to the side like that to shoot. But actually, yes, you would. That's exactly how you'd fire if you're going to be shooting two guns at the same time. But yeah, imagine you were someone that like shot yourself as, I'm sorry, not you, but someone that did that. It's like, oh crap, I'm not dead. I have to shoot myself again. And that'd be pretty fucking weird. But at the same time, it's pretty dark. I'll shut up.
Yeah, Yeah. I was just thinking of a Black Mirror episode. That was a good Black Mirror episode concept.
Still never seen it. But the one
show... Oh, my God. Okay, look. The one episode that you should see... The one episode... Seriously, man. They have some good episodes. But the one episode that I highly, highly recommend if you're into AI and, you know, kind of like dystopic futures and whatever. But it's called Hang the DJ. That's absolutely...
Because yeah, it kind of starts over every episode, right? It's like a new plot line.
Yeah, they're all separate episodes. Yep. It's just like Twilight Zone. It was just, you know.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. Yeah.
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 That's what it is. I was just going to say it's an updated version of Twilight Zone, in my opinion. But I have a concept I would love to see happen. I would call it Dreamscapes. And every episode could be, well, I mean, if you wanted to have a solid half hour or 45 minutes of content, but that whole amount of time could be cut into as many fractured episodes as you would like, because they are all dreams. Everything that you watch is like what you would necessarily maybe dream about yourself at night. And those episodes could just stop abruptly and just start with a new one. And you would have just this to me. So to me, that's just really interesting. But that people could, you would have unending content if you then said to the watchers, hey, if you can remember a dream that you've had, send it in and we'll make it into an episode. You would just have limitless content. You could make the whole episode, you know, one dream. And then, you know, in season one, you have this one dream. And then in season five, you have another aspect of that dream. I mean, you could just turn it into so many different multiverses of content. I think it's a great concept.
Yes. After the next break, I'm going to show you guys something kind of interesting I found, and I'm going to recommend a series of shows that just came out, and they're very good. I don't recommend stuff that's shit, so...
I will hold you to that, Andrew.
Okay.
Right. Yeah, I'll just give you a... I'll just give you a naysaying, except for Fallout. That's my opinion.
Well, it is Fallout.
That does bring us really close to the break there, Josh.
It certainly does.
What you thinking for the last song?
There were a few recommendations in chat. I know Liz had one as well.
Well, I know people can go to the, what is it? Patreon?
Yes, we have a Patreon chat. They've got chat threads that you can be a part of over there on Patreon.
And they always get the first come, first serve. Do we have any from over there? That
I don't think so. It seems like I was just on there yesterday, and I didn't see any. I can double check just to verify. I do not see anything.
Are those just like... are those just like public comment boards, or is it a live thread?
It's a live thread.
Oh, okay. Huh. Is it always running, or is it only when the show's on?
It's always running. It's just a regular, like, chat.
It's the site, yeah.
Chat room. Drop messages over there.
Amda says there's a bunch of songs on there that apparently we haven't gotten to, and certainly do that. You can ignore my... I usually go grab a song that's pertaining to what we're talking about, and then we're done with it by the time we actually hit the break, so it's still irrelevant at that point. So, yeah, you can skip mine for now.
Hey, while I was thinking
although
about
keep that last one on hand, because it is a 5.5-minute song, so it gives you plenty of getting ready time. Sorry, Travis, go ahead.
Oh, no, that's okay. I was just thinking about you on Wednesday when I had my song played, Pulled at a Calamity by Extreme. It was just a rock.
I know,
song
I saw that. I gave it a heart or a thumbs up or
oh,
something.
Oh, my God.
I saw it.
It was so funky. I loved Extreme. It. I was jamming out. I hadn't heard it in so long. It was just a great song. Lyrics are phenomenal, too. I think it's just so crappy.
Right. So apparently Nate is giving some love to us IRM metalheads. I think I'm really the only resident metalhead encamped here, Nate, but we appreciate it, brother. You have an amazing weekend. And I saw a shout out from Tommy at Flatfest in the chat, I believe, here with us on the call. I hope you guys are having a fucking blowout over there, brother.
So I do see some stuff here from Jason Talbot. Given the fact that we're already over the break, I'm just going to play what I got loaded up, and Monday I'll start rocking through these. Like, if somebody goes onto the chat and requests six songs, like, we only do, like, three a show. So I can't necessarily play all three songs from the same person for the whole show. I guess I could, but you're still losing three songs, then what? I've got to have you rate your top three out of that six as to which ones you actually want played for the show. Or I just got to try to stretch them out and refer back to it whenever I can.
You know, I was going to make a list on my phone for that very reason, so we could kind of keep up with what we played and not played, and I haven't done it. My bad.
Yeah, I think I ran into that on Wednesday, thinking I played a song that I'd already played. I mean, we've been playing songs for months now.
A minute now. Yeah, it's been a minute. I know we've had to have repeated at least once or three or four times even. So no big deal.
I don't think so. I think I've done pretty good at not repeating songs, I think. Well, here's one you may know. Aw, son of a bitch. Stupid music videos have all this shit. Like, I play them on my phone, I don't have to deal with it, but I couldn't find this song.
In constant sorrow all through his days. I am the man of constant sorrow. I've seen trouble. Where I was born and raised, the place where he was born and raised.
I'm almost never in the city. Yeah, I was born and bred in anymore, but everywhere I tour, I'm repping black and orange. I'm trekking back and forth, forgetting what I'm packing for. Have to travel more and add a couple saddle sores. Got these battle scars from riding in the cattle car. You're noshing on some caviar, I'm gnawing on your apple cores. Mental checklist, you're Mr. International, but last I checked, I'm Mr. Continental Breakfast. Condiments and checks, mixed condoms, but I'm sexless. But I'm optimistic, I'll dismiss my bigger issues when I fit into some mistress like the long block in Tetris. I was roaming in Wyoming when the popo were arresting me. I told him I was questing for my destiny. I always end up in detention cause I'm itching and I'm searching for adventure in each city I go.
Go, 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 go. It's fair thee well, my own true lover. I'll never expect to see you. I'll die up on this train.
Perhaps you'll die up on this train.
Papa is a head doctor. I think he's Socrates. But he can't get my twin brother to want to talk to me. But I rarely try, and so it's partly my hypocrisy. Got a couple secrets, tend to keep them under lock and key, and push them down, occasionally sparking up the broccoli. I'd rather take my lumps, display my dirty laundry, than pop a pill and stagger through this day like I'm a zombie. Like I'm some unnatural and unhappy blondie Abercrombie model with the fakest fucking smile plastered on me. Might be a sarcastic bastard, but I'm never plastic. And my masochistic tendencies, imagining disaster and then mastering its recipe. So I hit the road, of necessity to stop guarding, and I'll hop out and run if my car is not starting. For now I'm not charging all my meals or business meals, cause my business is not starving.
You can bury me in some deep valley for many years where I will live, and you may learn.
Four 4 a.m. again, the radio alarm is kicking in. Been to every shitty old La Quinta Inn in Michigan. Hitting the ignition till I'm stripping off my Michelins. If you catch me bitching, then remind me how magnificent my life is. How the struggle's priceless. Cause I got those lovely troubles that you couldn't put a damper on. Each unhappy camper on this planet is a champion. If you think you're hopeless, then you'll never be like Kobe. And you've got an empty mantle cause you never won a trophy. Man, well, you still won that marathon of swimming that fallopian. And I've learned I've got a lot I could lose, cause there's a lot of dead sperm in the socks that I've used. Who would love to be the feet in the socks in my shoes? So better get to walk until those spoiled feet are bruised. And then sow your royal oats until you're growing something new.
Maybe your friends, they think that I'm just a stranger.
They think I'm strange.
But my face you'll never
see.
A little bit of George Watsky for you. Covering and remixing Man of Constant Sorrow. And that wasn't even the best version. I think they even remixed that one into one that's a little bit better that I prefer. But this is the fourth and final segment of the IronWorX, kicking off right now. Freeworld.fm. Come check us out. Come hang out over there where all the good gifts live.
I like that little twisty twist.
Sorry about that. I was going to say, I'm a little disturbed because I'm trying to figure out why they sampled Man of Constant Sorrow, which means that I have to then go back and listen to the lyrics again. Because if, you know, like I'm listening to the lyrics and then I'm thinking, why is the Man of Constant Sorrow part of this song? Like, why did it do that? That was just me. I was like, caught up in that thought.
Yeah, it's one of those you might want to find a lyric video. George Watsky tends to go a little fast, so you're kind of hard to catch sometimes. So I'll drop the link, but see if I still can't come up with the better link, the better version of that song that I prefer.
Yeah, I thought it was catchy.
All right, Andrew, you're up.
Let's yeah, I'm trying songs. To... Hold on. Where? Okay, here we go. I think this is it. All right. I'm hiding the trivia right now. That's what I've been doing. So, in this episode, I'm not trying to give away anything.
Are you about to play from the show? Because it'll probably get us like knocked off the air, I would guess.
It'll be like 15 seconds.
It'll probably get us knocked off the air.
Okay, well, I won't do it then.
We can't play music video without getting knocked off the air, so I can't imagine
we'll do
a prime show without getting knocked off the air. Sorry, Andrew, I just...
No, it's perfectly okay. But what happens in this particular scene, this is episode 5, it's like, you know...
Plus, I haven't got to episode 5, you fucker, so stop. No, I'm kidding.
No, I'm not giving anything away, okay? But in this particular episode, I noticed it, and I haven't even seen the entire season yet. It's only 8 episodes, I think.
A still shot might get by if you had a picture of what you're trying to show us. If you tried that, maybe. I just, like I said, I know anytime we do video, it's not a kosher.
So,
well, my question, Andrew, is did you figure out how to have it show? Because as far as I know, Netflix and Prime, like if you try to share your screen and it's not in a share party format, then they block it. So did you figure out how to get around that?
Well, yeah, I can definitely do that. What I'm going to have to use is like either OBS or I'm going to have to use Demo Creator.
Well, yeah, but if you weren't set up to do that, then it wouldn't have shown anyway. That's what I'm saying.
Right. Okay.
Even if you push play right now, it wasn't set up to show
right,
us.
Right. Just go to their app on the show or whatever, and it won't show it. Right. I never have tried that, Travis. I didn't know.
So I can just, there was no audio. It's just showing. Okay. So at one point, they're going to be walking on this abandoned railroad track. And she has been living down inside of this vault or a bunker, for a long, long time, like her entire life. And the other guy's been alive for like 200 and something years somehow. It's based off the video game Fallout, which I've never played. And she comes up for the first time, and right here in this scene is when she's saying, so, we're, flat Earth, globe Earth, like, what is everyone's, she says, like, what is everyone's agreement on that right now? Like, where are you guys at with that right now? And then, just a moment
yeah, no spoiler.
Later, hold on, right? Right there is the very next scene, and what do you see?
A black screen.
Nothing. Yeah.
A black screen.
We see nothing. That's what I'm telling you, man.
What is? Oh, they won't even let me do that? Wow.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Crap. Okay, there's no point in even sharing. So, yeah, they're walking on the railroad track, and she talks about flat Earth, globe Earth, and the very next scene it cuts to is a guy working on a computer, and there's a globe, like, right away. Talk about predictive programming.
Yeah, somehow
anyways,
I missed it.
I just thought I would bring that up. I happened to notice that when I was watching it. And I usually just watch it like in the background or something, but...
And here I thought, Andrew, you were trying to share your porn collection with us.
Say again, you're a little quiet.
That's okay, you don't want me to repeat it.
No, it's fine. I don't care.
So
if it was offensive, you can't offend me. I don't worry about that.
There was a whole lot of truth in that Fallout movie, I thought. It does have some corniness, but it's that same. It's a video game movie, so it's going to have that video game corniness.
I was just going to say the video game itself is pretty corny at times. That's kind of its retro future thing.
And I had never, I've not played that game either, so I don't know anything about
it. Yeah, they're phenomenal games. Like, they've stolen huge chunks of my life with those games, unfortunately.
Don't you mean willingly given?
Oh, no, I just checked it out to see what it was like. Then they stole the rest, had me under their control.
No, as soon as you guys all watch it, we'd love to do a little breakdown of it, because there's so
much.
Yeah,
we definitely
can.
There were Flat Earth references in the game. I had talked about it way, way back when I was replaying Fallout New Vegas, and there's a downloadable content you can get for that game that takes place at a drive-in theater. And there are these, yeah, these are spoilers, like everybody else does it. And there are these beings who have basically taken their brains out of their bodies and put them into jars and are like living that way. And they are talking to you as a character, trying to ask you, you still think the Earth's a ball and all this crazy shit. And it's like, what the fuck? It broke my brain because it was early in the Flat Earth voyage. I was trying to figure out a way to capture it and show it, but I couldn't, like, I didn't know how to do the, that was way before I had the computer I have now. So, sorry, go ahead, Nuke.
No, I'm saying that's a whole other question and a whole other debate about human consciousness. Is it in the brain? Is it somewhere else? If you are able to remove somebody's brain and keep it alive, are you still alive? Is your soul there? It's a whole bunch of things. But Andrew, you're not escaping. You said you had a bunch of shows for us to watch. You had recommendations. You didn't say one show.
Well, no, I was just recommending that.
There's
for now.
Eight of them. Eight shows on that one title.
Yeah, it's a series.
Okay.
They're an hour apiece. And it's surprisingly graphic, too. I didn't think it was going to be like that. I've never seen a video game that was graphic like that. I mean, point where it's like Walking Dead graphic.
You need to play some new games.
Yeah. And
I'm not sure what turned me off from it. I made it through two episodes. I might have started in the third, and I was just, I don't know. There was a couple of things that just, I was just like, eh. But, I mean, it had a bit of interest, of my interest for a while, but.
I mean, it gets better. I know at the beginning, I liked the beginning a lot, just the concept of it, because I didn't even know what the storyline of that game was. I'd go to my friend's house and just hang out for a while, and they'd be sitting back, you know, playing that game. And I was like, oh, it's another first-person shooter kind of thing. It's like, yeah, and
It is, but not just that at all.
But there, yeah, there's more to it than that.
There's a whole lot of storyline. There's a whole lot of actually having to figure shit out in that storyline. There's lots of choices you have to make, like what faction to hang. Well, as you see in the show, there's the Brotherhood of Steel. There's a lot of other factions they didn't even address. Then there's the whole ghoul thing that they kind of changed for the show. And as far as the goriness, there are these things you get as you level up, perk points that you can distribute amongst all of your like abilities, perception or agility or strength or whatever. And one of those, as you progress your shooting abilities, allows you to have an extra gory kill when you shoot a character or a creature or whatever you're fighting against. The gameplay or the gunplay in the game is really strange. You can literally focus in on a body part, like somebody's arm, and shoot it if that's the best points that you're going to get through the VATS system. Anyway, I'm getting way nerdy with this. The whole point is if you use this perk, when you make that shot, instead of just killing them, their head will explode and eyeballs will go everywhere. And so that's kind of where they got that idea, I guess, from in the show. Because it was a lot more graphic than I thought on the first two that I've watched.
Interesting. I don't think I've seen what you guys were talking about.
Well, the fact that it's based off the premise of an atomic bomb kind of already puts it into the high science fantasy for all of us, pretty much.
But then once you take into consideration companies like BlackRock and put that, watch it in that sort of, with that mentality.
Oh, fucking A, absolutely, dude. And some of the underground shit that's going on right now, and hell yeah.
Again, the two words that really defined that show was fiduciary responsibility. And for me, that's what sort of sums up that entire plot line. It's the fiduciary responsibility of companies like BlackRock. And just think about that when you watch the show fall out from start to finish.
To do what?
Exactly. That's
a super spoiler, and if we get into that, then I know basically because I played the games too, so I kind of know what you're kind of hinting around at there, Josh. I just wanted to see how they presented it in the game, right? So,
Well, I'm never gonna play these games ever, but it's like, is BlackRock another game?
It's a multinational private.
What are you laughing at me for, man?
It's a game, all right. It's a game, all right. That's why.
It's their game, yeah. We don't get to play in it. We're just the pawns.
We're the losers, right? We're the pieces, exactly.
Okay, so BlackRock is a company then?
Yes, BlackRock.
It's an investment management company, and their assets under management right now are $9.1 trillion. It's huge.
And they've had interesting people that are connected to them that you probably have heard a name or 80 of.
Eric Prince, I think, was the founder. You can find interviews from this guy all over the internet. He's gone since he's left BlackRock because he's the one that actually founded it. And it's one of those corporations that I think is basically run by an AI. So all the decisions they make are sort of AI based, and it's the whole process of collecting data, running these simulations to try to see how people are going to react, and then adjusting all of society accordingly. Well, again, we're going to get into the spoiler alerts for the Fallout show, but it's basically doing anything and everything within your limitless power to continue to make money for the shareholders, because that's your one and only job as a company. You have a fiduciary responsibility to continue to make money for the shareholders. That's your whole.
You mean system. Like if you were a medical company and you needed to continue raking in profits and like something that would guarantee? Oh, I better shut up before I get this show taken down.
There we go. BlackRock, Vanguard, the Wagner Group, all of these sort of huge multinational corporations that.
I wonder if we had the opportunity to participate in all of this, if you would do anything different to them, I mean.
Yeah, I don't know. Hard to say.
in my opinion, most of us would.
Wait, are you? What situation? What situation are you trying to?
If we were part of the elite, if we had all this money and power and whatever, we could do the
exact same thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, this is what I would love to do, right? Like, in my mind, I've got another show in my head where you've got this child of the elite and he has a conscience and he sees a glitch in the matrix on his side and he wants to get out because he's like, oh, this is what this is. This is what we're doing. This is who we have been. And then he wants to get out. Like, that would be an amazing, first episode, right? Like, you don't know what you're watching or whatever. It's like the gentleman, it's aristocracy and aristocracy, And one of the persons is just like, he just wakes up.
Well,
and he sees.
What's a conscious?
Well, that's King Arthur. That's Charlemagne. That's, all these supposed great kings of old that were actually good people and didn't follow along with all the other royals and stuff like that, who gave people, rights and freedoms and choices.
You know what? I had a conversation with someone last week, and maybe a light bulb went off. You can tell me if it's not or if it is on or off. But King Arthur is possibly Ursa Major, and the Knights of the Round Table is the Zodiac. This is just another story that the stars tell.
Could be.
You know what I mean? You've got the sword, Excalibur, you've got the Southern Cross, all of these symbols of crosses, and that's what the hilt of a sword is. Oh, then you know what? Yeah. I was watching Mandy. I don't know if you guys have seen Mandy, Nicolas Cage or whatever. It's a really artsy film. So
it's a great movie, dude.
Yeah. I appreciated it as an art film. I didn't appreciate it for anything else. But there was a scene in a chapel where the cross was in place just in line with the pulpit. And Nicolas Cage is walking up like he's Arthur and he's going to pull the sword out of the stone. And I'm just like, this is just fucking another King Arthur story. You know what I mean? He's whatever. Just so anyway,
Yeah.
Travis, going back to your story idea about the guy who's part of the elite and wants to break out and whatever. You said he has a conscience. What is that?
Well, I suppose it would be that thing that wakes up, that recognizes, for yourself, what do you recognize as something that you have a moral decision to, carry out? Are you thoughtful about those things? If you're not thoughtful about those things, then I would say you don't have a conscience. You don't have that thing that makes it obvious what is good and what is not so good.
Why should one individual care about the needs of many? We're not in a hive mind. We're all individuals.
He broke off for me. I didn't hear what he asked.
Yeah, I kind of missed it too. What was that, Nuka?
I said, but why should one individual have to care about the needs of many or the wants of many? We're not a hive mind. We're all individuals.
Exactly. They don't have to.
Because that is us remembering that we're not all individuals. That we are a consciousness that has fractured to experience individuality and choices and cause and effect and love and hate and all these things that we deal with that we're all railing against, that we should just enjoy the ride. Where you at, David M? Where you at, Daz?
Walter, that's great. And what if they don't share those beliefs?
Then that's when you figure out a way to defend yourself or call out things or sit on a podcast a few times a week railing against the wall and hoping that seeds get planted. I mean, that's truly it, dude. You have to figure out what lets you sleep at night. I've done things I feel that have helped. Hell, dude, how did I meet you, Nuka? From a fucking video on my channel. I never would have known you as an amazing, beautiful soul like you are if I hadn't done that. So even just that one thing makes it all worthwhile. But I've met so many other people, and it's been a beautiful thing. So regardless of whether the seeds were planted or whether the whatever gets changed, my soul feels good about the energy and the connections and the, you know, the stuff I've shared and tried to discern. I was also going to speak to what David is talking about, more TV and movie talk. Well, you know, part of it is the world we're in and that we're trying to discern the usefulness and try to show the people who aren't as aware or awake or discerning, look, there's more going on here than a fucking show about a radioactive fallout, and there's more going on in this movie than whatever. I don't know. I can't think of a movie offhand. Exactly, Bill and Tano.
Oh, yeah,
it's
truth and
just a ride. That's why that shit is on my body. The only tattoo I have is it's just a ride. Sorry, go ahead.
I was just saying, yeah, truth in movies, lies in the news, right? So when they show
exactly.
We pointed out that, yeah, this isn't just a show that they're talking about. This is really taking place and going on, and this is, you know, tied to this right here. I love South Park for that. They're great at it. Like when they did the whole Federal Express. We're going to take down Federal Express, and they tell them, you know, the Federal Express isn't part of the federal government, right? So, well, they were talking.
Yeah, but
curve right there. They weren't talking about Federal Express. For those people who know, they were talking about the Federal Reserve and how it isn't part of the federal government.
Right, but in my opinion, those writers are members of the club, and
they're just
I mean, it's not like you or I, you know, broke the code and we start writing South Park and everybody's just like, oh, what's this weird, you know, subliminal messages? You're like, no, these guys are like, they're just waving, they're just flaunting it in front of our face, you know? It's just absolutely ridiculous. And we're just,
look how blatant the Simpsons are.
I know, man.
President 2016 and 2024, like a decade ago, a decade before he was ever president in 2016.
Oh, buddy, you gotta get
off. Well, I mean, I'm gonna be a stickler and correct you. It's not predictive. It's just a program.
Oh yeah,
that's, you know, yeah.
But normally they predicted it, right?
Because that's what people think. That's why people.
But that's about it, guys. I mean, we are right up near the end of the show here. Thank you guys so much for coming and hanging out. That flew by.
Should have started with this topic.
And I will say that Greece...
We got to it when we should have. Go ahead, John.
Greece is about due for a complete and total population collapse.
Yeah, I saw that. Crazy.
The death rate is twice. Almost twice the birth rate. It'll be the first, I think, society in history known to just undergo that complete population collapse. I just thought that was interesting. The way so many countries are following that same thing, where you just can't replace the people that are leaving. It's the exponential decline anyway.
But that's if you believe their numbers.
If you believe their numbers.
Population.
That's true. So a bunch of people in France or Greece dying from blood clots and coronary diseases. Huge increase. Don't know why that might have happened, but give it a thought, ponder on it, and we'll discuss it maybe.
They drink a lot of olive oil there too.
There you go. Maybe that's what it is.
It's great for your heart. Great for your heart. I'm just saying. You would think something like that wouldn't happen in that population.
You'd think.
Never has before,
right?
A 2020 date or whatever.
Now, we don't want to get into the
why.
A lot of fast food.
Love you. Thank you guys so much.
Love you guys. Have a great weekend. Have a great rest of your week. We'll see you back here Monday morning for more of the IRONWORX right here on freeworld.fm. Until then, guys, be good, be well, do good, do it well. We love you. Bye-bye.